Forrester Award now. So, Holly, please come up here. Take it away. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Jay Forrester Award presentation ceremony. The award, let me say a word about the sequence of events here. I'll announce the award and read the citation, after which the award will be presented. Following this, the recipient will deliver the customary Jay Wright Forrester Award lecture. And after that lecture, there will be opportunity to meet the recipient, photographs, and whatever. My name is Khalid Saeed. I chair the Jay Wright Forrester Award Committee this year. Other members on the committee are John Stillman, Jack Homer, Erling Moxness, and Kim Thompson. Folks, if you are here, you can come up or sit wherever you like. The Jay Wright Forrester Award is presented as often as once annually for the best contribution to the field of system dynamics during the preceding 5 years. The recipient receives a commemorative plaque and $5,000. Papers, articles, books, research or consulting reports, theses or other written material that have been published or in the publishable form in English language, in the original or after translation, are eligible for consideration. And we urge you to nominate the people that you think are appropriate for receiving the award. I'm happy to say, though, this year that we received a record number of nominations that kept the Jay Forrester Award Committee very busy. My thanks to the nominators. I also acknowledge the hard work of my colleagues on the committee who diligently evaluated the large number of nominations. And now the citation and the announcement. The recipient of the 26th Jay Wright Forrester Award is Hazhir Rahmandad. The award is presented for Hazhir's article, Impact of Growth Opportunities and Competition on Firm Level Capability Development Trade-offs, published in 2012 in Organization Science, Volume 23, Issue 1, pages 138 to 154. In this paper, Hazhir addresses several enduring and important puzzles in organization theory and strategy. Economic theory suggests that firms compete in markets, should converge, and they converge to the conventional equilibrium of zero economic profits. If a firm somehow develops superior technology or knowledge conferring an advantage, then competition, learning, imitation, reverse engineering, and other processes should enable rivals to level the playing field. But in fact, large persistent variations are the norm, even in organizations that are essentially identical. Popular theories to explain this puzzle include the resource-based view of the firm and the concept of dynamic capabilities, in which firms develop organization-specific knowledge, relationships, routines, and other intangible assets that create superior capabilities. There is broad agreement that capabilities accumulate but there is little understanding of the factors that determine the rate of accumulation, and especially how the dynamics of capabilities are conditioned by feedbacks internal to the firm and between the firm and the market. Prior work in system dynamics has led to the concept of the capability trap, in which pressures to meet production or financial targets lead to corner cutting that compromises maintenance, process improvement, morale, and safety. This then causes firm capabilities and performance to erode, which further increases production and financial pressures. A vicious cycle so created may not only lead to organizational failure, but also to cause environmental damage and fatal accidents. The capability trap thesis urges managers to focus on working smarter, to build capabilities, and avoid the trap of working harder to hit short-term targets. The capability traps framework, however, examines firms in isolation from the markets in which they compete. Hazhir extends this work by developing and analyzing a system dynamics model in which firms must choose to invest their limited resources to be able to compete better in the marketplace. Firms allocate resources between two types of capabilities: operational capabilities like workers, equipment, and processes that determine the volume of output, and dynamic capabilities like R&D and training that enhance the operational capabilities. While managers in Hazhir's model face trade-offs between working harder and working smarter, as in prior work, resources are treated endogenously and are impacted by competition. Working harder generates short-term profits that enhance resources for further growth. With systematic and innovative sensitivity testing, Hazhir demonstrates the circumstances under which working smarter is better, and also the situations in which working harder is superior. A result which is novel and reminds us that policy conclusions may often be contingent. Hazhir's paper goes to the heart of one of the most important debates in the field of strategy and organizations theory. Like all of Hazhir's work, the model is original and elegant, and the analysis rigorous and insightful. With a model simple enough to present fully and analyze rigorously in only 17 pages, Hazhir addresses and interrelates an array of difficult issues, including endogenous firm performance, resources, and competition. This is exemplary system dynamics and exemplary social science. We are therefore delighted to present the 2015 Jay Wright Forrester Award to Hazhir Rahmandad.
Servant and Nelson Levening, who have introduced me to this beautiful field and have supported and mentored me ever since. I feel very lucky to be part of this community. From my first days in the PhD program, I have had the privilege of learning from a wonderful group of friends, including Laura Black, Brad Morrison, Paolo Goncalves, Mila Getmansky, Yaron Stolben, Gökhan Dogan, Dan McCarty, Tim Queen, as well as thoughtful teachers such as Jim Hines, Oliver Line, and Jim Linus. George Richardson, David Anderson, and the Albany crew have provided thoughtful and great feedback and supportive environment in our biannual MIT Albany PhD colloquiums. And Rogelio Oliva, Yerker Dandrell, Mohammad Mushahedzadeh, Scott Rockhart, Navid Hafarzadeh-Ban, and numerous seminar participants and anonymous reviewers have offered great feedback in the development of work that is being recognized by this award today. I'm also very much thankful to you, the members of the System Dynamics community, who have made this conference not only a great venue for learning, but also a fun event where I meet friends and colleagues I both esteem and enjoy hanging out with. Finally, I'm very much grateful to my wife, Sarah, who has lovingly put up with a partner who thinks more about models than real stuff. So, in the talk today, I pursue three objectives. First, I want to provide an overview of the research and findings in my article, Impact of Growth Opportunities and Competition on Firm Level Capability Development Trade-offs, that has been recognized by this award. Second, I want to highlight some of the assumptions and methods used in this research, which may not be commonly used in system dynamics, and I hope there is something for some of the members of the community for their projects using some of those assumptions and methods. And finally, I want to share some reflections on the process of conducting system dynamics research that targets academic audiences outside of our community. So, with that introduction, let me get started with the story of this research. And the story starts with this guy, who is a good friend of mine. He is a software entrepreneur in California. He has been involved in building a few different startups. And we have regular chats about different things, including his business. And a few years ago, we were talking about the challenges he was facing in developing new features for his startup software, and also keeping in mind that he wanted to have a flexible architecture that the future releases of his work would be competitive and can go forward. And so these are a couple of companies he has been involved with and has been pushing forward, and one of them is still around. So at the time, I was involved in researching capabilities. I had done some work in understanding challenges in developing new software products. So I felt that I knew something about what he was doing. And from our conversations, the MITU kind of theoretical framework and insights that were coming to my mind related to the work which we know in the system dynamics community around capability development and around challenges managers face when they're dealing with investments in different types of activities, some of which may pay off quickly and some of which may be long-term capabilities. So there's good research showing that managers in these settings could be myopic and could underinvest in long-term capabilities. For example, they may be underinvesting in proactive maintenance and getting stuck in doing reactive maintenance. John Sturman had a great talk yesterday looking at some of those dynamics at MIT and also how to overcome some of those challenges. There is a lot of research on process improvement. Nelson Rupenning has been pushing that front forward in multiple publications, showing that process improvement initiatives, because of their long lags until they pay off, they can easily sacrifice in favor of just getting the production up. There are similar challenges in product development, in trade-offs between investing in concept design and detailed design, in software development. Nelson and I have a paper, and we're presenting that today as well, looking at similar trade-offs. And in many different areas, Morrison has work related to this team of capability traps. The basic insight from this research is essentially when you are trying to invest in different types of capabilities, you're prone as a manager to underinvest in long-term initiatives. And I was looking at my friend's company and I was saying, well, it seems to be a similar issue. You are trying to get things done quickly, get features out, and therefore you are not investing in the longer-term issues such as developing a good testing suite and having higher quality processes for your development process, investing in the architecture of your software, and those are things that you will need a few months or maybe a couple of years down the road to survive in this market. And so that was a theoretical frame, and actually I was working on research to making that kind of a generic model. So that generic model builds on the research in the resource-based view of the firm. This is coming from the strategy literature. And the big question in the strategy literature is why do we see firms that have fairly different performance, even though they are in similar markets and looking at similar problems? Why don't they learn quickly from each other, imitate each other's processes, do reverse engineering and so on, and therefore converge to very similar types of activities? Why do we see heterogeneous performance? Why some firms succeed? That's the driving question for strategy. And that basic question in the resource-based view is answered through looking at inside the firm and thinking about firms as bundles of capabilities and assets in the sense that there are physical assets, machinery, technologies, and equipment, and human workers, and so on, who are contributing to the production process, and capabilities, which are essentially routines that combine those technologies and human resources and intangible assets such as reputation and so on together and let the firm do what it does on a day-to-day basis. But also there are routines that are targeting rejuvenation of those core capabilities. So there are routines that can help you build future products and so on. And this literature recognizes that capabilities have inertia. They are built over time through long-term investments. They also erode over time because the markets change and some of the capabilities you currently have become irrelevant because you have organizational forgetting. People just lose some of their normal high-quality work processes. People leave organizations. So there are lots of reasons why capabilities erode as well. So the theoretical framework is actually very much close to what we think about when we are thinking about organizations. When we look at modeling an organization, we think about what are the important stocks that capture both the inertia and the production processes inside that organization. So in that sense, strategy literature is very close to system dynamics, but it is also a little bit more theoretical in its framing of these issues and kind of tries to look at these at a more generic level. So specifically, when the strategy literature cares more about capabilities because capabilities are the things that are hard to imitate, hard to just create. You can't go to the market and buy some new capabilities. You have to create those routines inside your own firm. So if there is differences across organizations, the theory suggests it should be because of differences between capabilities that organizations have, not because of their physical assets. The physical assets you can go and buy in the market, so you don't have any competitive advantage compared to others. Can also go and buy the same physical assets in the market. What distinguishes between the firms is their capabilities. And generally speaking, capabilities are divided into two types of capabilities. Operational capabilities are those routines that allow the firm to accomplish its day-to-day goals, to just produce, sell, and make a living. So production processes in a manufacturing firm are operational capabilities. They allow the firm to generate its output. On the other hand, there are dynamic capabilities, which are routines that are used for changing those operational capabilities. So for example, you have a productive product development process, which allows you to build better products for your future production processes, makes your future production processes more efficient, and as a result, contributes to your long-term success. And there is a lot of emphasis in the last decade or decade and a half on dynamic capabilities as the main driver of competitive advantage in lots of markets, because people say markets are very dynamic, everything is changing, operational capabilities become obsolete very quickly, so you need to have routines that allow you to actually rejuvenate and change those operational capabilities. So those dynamic capabilities are pretty important to be captured. But there is also an important wrinkle in this theoretical framework, and that is you don't really need to have dynamic capabilities to improve and fix your operational capabilities. you can fix those problems whenever they come. So if you need a new product, you can build a new product through a product development process that is well established, it is a routine and therefore a dynamic capability. Or you can go out and acquire a new firm, which has some new product and use that new firm acquisition to push forward your operational capability in future to product for new problems. So that's an example of ad hoc problem solving that could be used instead of using dynamic capabilities. So the firms have the option of using ad hoc problem solving to improve their operational capability or using dynamic capabilities. So this was the theoretical framework I was starting with, and I was kind of building models along these lines and trying to capture a generic SD model that starts from the strategy literature, learns from the insights in the previous work in the system dynamics literature, and brings them together to show some of the trade-offs that we have talked about in the system dynamics literature. And here is kind of a quick overview of that model. So what you can see here is that we have the operational capability as the main driver of firm's performance. There is an erosion rate for it. And there are investments that go into this operational capability, and the efficiency of those investments, that is for each unit of investment, how much operational capability you create, that efficiency depends both on your dynamic capabilities and the efficiency of doing ad hoc problem solving. So depending on which of these two is more efficient, you use that method for building operational capabilities, and that will allow you to increase your operational capability. And of course, you have dynamic capabilities that also are increased through investments in dynamic capabilities and erode over time. So any increase in operational capability depends on both the dynamic capability and potentially the ad hoc problem solving. And in the literature, there is good evidence that dynamic capabilities have decreasing returns. That is, as you have more and more dynamic capabilities, you don't increase your efficiency proportionally, you increase it with a slower and slower rate. And here are just some examples of operational and dynamic capabilities. So production processes, we had the example, and product development allows you to have better production processes in future in terms of more productive production processes because you have better products that are more profitable. Similarly, for a sales organization, your routines for human resource training allow you to build better sales force in future. So those are dynamic capabilities that go into the sales. And production processes could also be enhanced through process improvement. So process improvement capability is a dynamic capability. And similarly, you can use other examples. So maintenance can also influence production processes, and alliance formation can enhance your marketing and so on. So this is the big picture of translating that research and strategy into a simple SD model with just two stock variables. And you can quickly see where I'm going. So next step is, what is the role of managers here? What decision is being made? And the key decision for the manager is to allocate resources between these two types of capabilities. So the manager has some total effort. This is the number of hours that people in the organization have at their disposal that they could invest into these different types of capabilities. And that number of hours could be allocated to operational capabilities or dynamic capabilities, that there is a parameter that captures the trade-off. So you can have that fraction between 0 and 1 going to dynamic capabilities. So I was looking at my friend's firm, and I was starting with the assumption that, yeah, he's probably over-investing in operational capabilities and under-investing in dynamic capabilities. That was my initial guess. And actually, I had kind of even a model of learning that explained that. So if you could think about what dynamics pursue from this simple model. If you start with an initial level of operational fraction of allocation fraction to dynamic capabilities, around 10%, which is underinvesting in dynamic capabilities, around 25-24% being kind of the efficient allocation, and you want to move towards that better allocation, if you're originally underinvesting and you want to go towards the efficient allocation, and you make that switch, in the short run, your performance actually goes down. This is the worst before better dynamic that we have seen in many different settings. And the basic mechanism is that because there is a delay here between investments in dynamic capabilities and their impact on performance, because first you have to build dynamic capabilities and then performance. So when you start relocating investments towards dynamic capabilities, In the short run, your operational capability actually goes down because you still haven't increased your dynamic capability by much, but your operational capability starts to erode, and therefore your performance goes down. Only when you have accumulated enough dynamic capabilities to compensate for that loss of operational capability through additional efficiency of investments, that is when you start to see a recovery of performance. So this is the worst before better trade-off, and you can actually show the better before worse trade-off if you go the other way. That is, if you cut investments in operational, in dynamic capabilities and move towards operational capabilities. In fact, we can actually kind of map the basic steady-state performance out of this system. So here is the steady-state performance, that is for different levels of allocation fraction between 0 and 1. What performance level do we get when the system is in a steady state, that is, all of the dynamics have settled? So here, for the 25% allocation fraction, this value is around the peak here, around here. And as you can see, if you invest nothing in operational capability, in dynamic capabilities, so if you're at f of 0, you actually are getting some performance because of having ad hoc problem solving. Your ad hoc problem solving allows you to build some operational capability and you get some performance. And in fact, at very low levels of investment in dynamic capabilities, you don't benefit from some investment because it's still ad hoc problem solving is beneficial. So you end up actually wasting resources in trying to build a dynamic capability that doesn't really add much value. You are still better off to acquire a firm than having a pretty lousy product development process. So whatever investment you have in that product development process is going to be wasted, and in that sense hurts your performance. Until you start to have good enough a dynamic capability that it becomes more efficient than ad hoc problem solving. And at that point, you start to see an increasing return on additional investments in dynamic capabilities until you get to a peak where you have the maximum long-term performance. So this is pretty much the common underlying model in a generic sense that we have seen in many of these short-term versus long-term trade-offs. And in fact, if you try to see how managers learn when they are interacting with this system, you can create a simple learning algorithm that says, if I make a change in my investment in my F function, and I see a change in my performance, I look and see whether an increase in F led to an increase in my cumulative performance or a decrease in my cumulative performance. And based on that, I change my F function either in the same direction if I have seen an improvement or in the opposite direction if I have seen a loss. So if we use that type of learning algorithm, we can see that managers usually end up with investing little or nothing in dynamic capabilities. So the red line here shows the fraction of investment in dynamic capabilities. And this manager is starting from somewhere around 40% investment in dynamic capabilities, that is just over-investing at the beginning. But then over time, through these experimentations, he's learning to reduce investments in dynamic capabilities, but essentially reduces it further and further. Doesn't stay around this 24-5% that is the optimum level, but goes even further because any change in the dynamic, any reduction in dynamic capability leads to an improvement in performance in the short run. From that experience, the manager learns this was a good change and continues going in that same direction. So this was a learning model that came on top of the core worse before better, better before worse trade-offs and shows with plausible learning heuristics we should expect underinvestments in dynamic capabilities in many markets. So I started with this. I kind of talked about these basic dynamics with my friend. And I was highlighting the challenge that he might be facing in learning the right lesson from his experience. And he kind of acknowledged that these dynamics exist and that the dynamic capabilities are important and it's easy to underinvest in them. But he said, I really am taking those into consideration, and still I find it very hard to invest in dynamic capabilities in these longer term factors. Because essentially I have a couple of months to show that my software works, or I wouldn't get the next round of funding. And if I don't get the next round of funding, I'm done. And there is no point in investing in an architecture for 2 years ahead if I can't survive. And I'm really worried that there are two other firms who are working on the same idea. If they are first in this market, they'll take the market share. There is not enough space for five competitors. And again, I'm screwed. So he had a good logic, and I didn't have a good theoretical explanation in my original story to capture his argument. So I decided that I actually have to expand the boundary of my model. And that's kind of got me started in this journey that led to the paper. So the first argument that he had was that essentially the next round of funding is important. It gives me the resources I need for investment in my operational capability as well as my dynamic capabilities. So the effort that you're talking about, the resources that the firm has for investment, these are not exogenous fixed efforts. They are endogenous part of dynamics. And if we include that endogeneity, maybe the results change. So this is very simple. You just say a fraction of profits of the firm go to reinvestment into capabilities. Let's see what we get out of doing that type of, adding that piece of feedback. And actually, it creates two reinforcing loops. One, that both of them are reinforcing loops that go through increases in capabilities and led to increases in performance and effort available. And they compete with each other. So if you have a market that is unlimited and you have a profitable firm, you can grow through your increasing your operational capabilities and building more performance and building more effort for further investment, or increasing your dynamic capabilities. And they have different speeds. So that's the core mechanism that comes into the model. And let's see what happens as a result of adding that mechanism. So here are just a few simulations with four firms using different fractions of investment into dynamic capabilities. And as you remember, in the previous case, we have set up the numbers so that F function around 0.24 was optimal in the fixed effort when there is no endogeneity of effort. But once we make the effort endogenous, smaller values of F seem to grow even faster. So if F equals 0.08 here, actually it grows much faster than F of 0.2. And if you have very large F values, you actually don't make money, you are not profitable, and therefore you actually lose, that becomes your capability erosion rate takes over because you don't make any investment in capabilities and you die out. So the important thing here is that the short-term growth loop, the growth loop that goes through the operational capability, is faster. If you invest in that loop, in the next few months, you start to see some benefits from it. And that allows you to expand the pool of resources available to you so that in the next year, you have more resources to invest in both types of capabilities. Whereas if you invested in the dynamic capability, it takes more time. And therefore, it takes a couple of years maybe before you have additional resources to invest in both types of capabilities. So that shifts the priority towards more shorter term goals. That's the basic insight. And if you do the sensitivity analysis with all different levels of F, this is performance with the endogenous effort, with this additional loop included. And of course, the scales are different, because when you add an endogenous growth, you have a reinforcing loop that takes over. So you look at the fractional growth rate rather than absolute performance values. But the key thing is that the peak of performance, rather than 0.24 or whatever it was, it comes down to 0.08 or so in this numerical example. So essentially, because of value of short-term growth in increasing your effort and resources available, you shift the performance or efficient allocation towards more short-term focused operational capabilities. And in fact, you still have some trade-offs over time. That is, if you look at what is the efficient allocation, what is this peak over time, that is, in the very short run or in the longer term, that peak starts to be around zero. That is, if you were in trying to look at performance growth over only a few periods of time, less than 10 periods of time, you would invest nothing in dynamic capabilities. You would go all for operational capabilities, and that loop will be fast enough. Only over some time period, you start to see the benefits of dynamic capabilities. So in that sense, we still have that short-term versus long-term trade-off, but in a more subtle way, in a way that changes the speed of growth in an endogenous setup. Moreover, this shift in capability in the efficient allocation is pretty significant. So if you start going from a fully exogenous model on the left-hand side, an exogenous effort in the sense there is no feedback, to a fully endogenous one, that is, we have that feedback loop completely incorporated, you see the efficient allocation change from 0.24 to 0.7 or so over different levels gradually. And even though it shifts pretty significantly, the results are fairly robust to what fraction of total profit is reinvested into capability development. So for different fractions of investment in capability development, we see the long-term peak, which is this number here around 0.7, to be all around 0.7, 0.8. In fact, if you have a very large fraction reinvested, the firm grows very fast. So in the long run, it saturates the benefits of dynamic capabilities, so the peak actually goes down a little bit. So that's kind of a second mechanism that influences the dynamics. So actually, by just incorporating this endogeneity of resources available to firm, I could see there is something to what my friend has in terms of his argument for not investing that much in those dynamic capabilities. That there might be the fact that I can benefit from growing my resources by focusing on these operational capabilities, and there is a point to that argument. But then he had another piece of the argument, and that was the impact of competition. So I decided to incorporate that into the model as well. So far we have had only a single firm, either with endogenous resource or fixed effort, but we could actually have many firms in the market that are competing against each other, and they are coupled through a market share mechanism in which their share of the market is their share of the potential output. So the more operational capabilities they have, they get a bigger share of the market. Now, if the market is very large, they are not really competing against each other for some time until they saturate the market. If the market is saturated, they are directly competing against each other, and it's a zero-sum game. So we can actually incorporate that, and we can have a fixed market size, similar firms that are exactly like each other, except that they have different F values, different allocation policies, that allows us to see which allocation policy is stronger in that market. And we can start from equal market shares, so that nobody has advantage over others, and look at the dynamics of market share over time. So here's one example of such a simulation. Here we have four policies compared to each other. The red one is zero investment in dynamic capabilities, green one is 5%, blue one is 10%, and black one is 15%. So in this market, this is a large market, so at the beginning, the firms are essentially not really competing with each other in the sense that the market allows all of them to get whatever, to sell whatever they produce, and that allows initially the firm with no dynamic capability investment to grow fastest, but then this firm starts to fall behind because others who have invested in dynamic capabilities start to catch up because of higher efficiency of their future investments in operational capability. So over time you can see that the firm with about 10% investment in dynamic capabilities seem to dominate in this market. But if you have a zero-sum game, a saturated market from the beginning, you get a different behavior here. That is, the firm with zero investment in dynamic capabilities dominates right away, because that is the firm who is growing fastest at the very beginning and taking away resources from the other firms, because it is getting a bigger market share. And because the other firms are losing market share, they don't have enough investment for future, and that pushes them down. So essentially, the ordering of performance is very much reverse to their investment in dynamic capabilities. So the firms with lower investment in dynamic capabilities actually end up winning in the saturated markets. So this is a second mechanism. Not only endogeneity of effort is important, but also market pressures can actually push the capabilities, dynamic capabilities, to a lower priority, because if you invest in them too much, you will lose market share, you wouldn't have much left for future investments. So the firms have a window of opportunity to invest in dynamic capabilities before they get to a saturated market in which it is a zero-sum game, it is very competitive, you can't actually have much time and effort in investment. Now, if you show this analysis to an economist, they would say, why not think about firms that are changing their policy based on others' responses? So this fraction of allocation is something that firms are strategically trying to optimize based on what other firms are doing. So you can actually think of this as a game theory, a game theoretic setup in which you have a game between different firms, and each firm is trying to pick the allocation fraction that helps them get the maximum performance over the long term and try to solve that. And in this setup, it's a relatively complex model to solve the Nash equilibrium, which is the solution of that game with analytical methods, but we can actually solve that numerically. And the numerical solution for this game has a simple intuition. Essentially, if you are in a saturated market, you have a zero-sum game. So the firms that have lower Fs compared to the rest of the pack, you are going to gain market share. At the beginning, that's what happens. And therefore, strategically, all firms want to be kind of in the lower half of F values. And looking at that dynamic and thinking ahead that other firms are also thinking the same way, the Nash equilibrium for that game becomes zero investment in dynamic capabilities. So actually you will get to an equilibrium of no investment in dynamic capabilities, only relying on ad hoc problem solving, which was what I was essentially observing in my friend's firm as the Nash equilibrium of that game. So it is not the one that maximizes the speed of growth, it is the one that is dominated based on the pressures from the market. So this is kind of the big picture of the core mechanisms that adding these two layers or additions to our original model of capability traps can bring about in terms of trade-offs between operational and dynamic capabilities. So let me summarize it in one figure. So we start with what the fixed effort peak is in dynamic capability investments, and it is usually a higher value. And then you get a significant shift to the left-hand side towards lower investment in dynamic capabilities when we capture the endogeneity of effort available to the firms. And then we will have even more shifts to the left-hand side when you have competition. And depending on the assumptions we impose in the competition on the rationality of players, we can get different shifts. So if you don't assume that the firms are rational, but assume that they have embedded routines and managerial heuristics that are inertial, and therefore they don't change that fraction easily, and they don't foresee what others firm do, then you might shift a little bit to the left. If you assume that they are acting strategically, you shift even further to the left-hand side, potentially to zero levels. And depending on different market conditions, this equilibrium could go all the way to the zero, or could stay at higher values than zero. And that's kind of the other part that I've done work on, to try to map out under what conditions these dynamics really shift the investment in dynamic capability towards zero, and under what conditions dynamic capabilities survive and are beneficial, but potentially not at the level that they would be if it was a fixed effort, exogenous effort. So the results are generally pretty robust to different parameter settings, as long as the firms are profitable and therefore they can grow and the endogenous closed loops are active. If you have decreasing returns on operational capabilities, then it didn't have that much impact, but it essentially, competition makes it harder for firms to escape the efficient allocation policy, because when you have increasing returns, some firms by luck may grow so big that even though they are inefficient in their allocation, they are big enough that they are more efficient than everybody else, because they are benefiting from those network effects and increasing return dynamics, and therefore you may see firms with inefficient allocation policies dominating the competition, whereas when you have a decreasing return, you don't see that dynamic. That's the main impact. You may have time compression diseconomies, which is a mouthful for just saying it is not very efficient to allocate a lot of resources to one type of capability, because you can't build it very quickly. If you want to build something too quickly, it becomes inefficient in building that. And that has some impact. So it essentially says, if you go to the F values of 0 or 1, you are wasting resources because you're really focusing on one thing, and that becomes inefficient. And as a result, the equilibriums become further concentrated in the middle of the range between 0 and 1 in our F values. So if you have buffer between profits and investment in capabilities, which is actually a pretty common scenario, that is, it takes time between you make the profit and you decide how much of it you want to invest in capabilities, and that cash buffer, that slows down those growth loops, because now you have introduced a delay in the middle of the reinforcing loop. And because that slows down the growth loop, it ends up reducing the strength of these dynamics that I elicited here. So essentially, if you take that delay to infinity, you have an exogenous resource base, so you have none of these dynamics. So you can see it essentially changes between zero delay and infinity delay in this setup. So that buffer is an important assumption that we have here. If you add that buffer, you can reduce the strength of these dynamics. If you have a single capability, and actually John showed a nice model yesterday that has a single capability rather than two capabilities, and you think about resource allocation between that single capability or just doing the work and getting things done and selling it as creating performance, you essentially see the same dynamics. So you don't need to have two types of capabilities. You can even go with a single capability model and build it. So for each of these setups, I have redone all of the analysis with a whole new model with a different formulation that captures an alternative assumption and show whether it makes a difference or not. So if you think about dynamic capabilities impacting the productivity of operational capabilities and not the efficiency of investment in those capabilities, you see pretty much the same dynamics. If you make the assumption that ad hoc problem solving works together with dynamic capability, not as a replacement of dynamic capability, then you get some impact. That is, the strategic equilibrium becomes non-zero, because even zero, a little bit investment in dynamic capabilities at that point of close to f of zero is still beneficial, because it's additive with the ad hoc problem solving. So it changes the strategic equilibrium towards having some investment in dynamic capabilities. And if you have larger markets that are unsaturated for a longer time horizon, you will get strategic equilibria that are non-zero as well. So that's a summary of kind of sensitivity analysis that I conducted on this to build confidence that the results are not limited to just these parameter settings I'm using, but to a wider range of assumptions, both on the model formulations and structures and the parameters of the model. So to summarize some of the theoretical implications of this work. So the basic insight is that the efficient allocation, what we think is the right thing for managers to do, very much depends on the level of competitiveness of the market and how endogenous those efforts, that resources that are to the manager. So if you're looking at a business unit that has fixed allocation of budget from the higher up managers, or that fixed allocation is updated in very, very long delays, you have a different recommendation as a managerial recommendation for how they should invest their resources compared to a startup who is getting all of their resources right based on their recent performance. So the previous research to a large extent hasn't focused on a single firm and has assumed that the resource is fairly exogenous, but that only leads to conclusions that are useful for that setup. But when we change the assumptions, we actually can get different results in terms of efficient allocation. An interesting kind of counterintuitive outcome that came out of this research and kind of challenges the mainstream understanding in the strategy literature is that dynamic capabilities are not necessarily a good thing in dynamic markets. So dynamic markets, the argument goes in strategy research, do depreciate, do erode the operational capabilities faster, and as a result, you need dynamic capabilities to replace them more quickly. That's the argument that strategy literature has. But if you have a market that is eroding your routines because it changes everything fairly quickly, it is also eroding your dynamic capabilities. So actually, in the balance between dynamic capabilities and ad hoc problem solving, a more dynamic market reduces the benefits of dynamic capabilities as long as it leads to erosion of dynamic capabilities. Now, you may make an argument that dynamic markets do not translate into faster erosion of dynamic capabilities because dynamic capabilities are somewhat different than operational capabilities. And that's a fair argument to have. But the literature in strategy has not made this first distinction to go into that next level of argument. So that's one other kind of theoretical tidbit. And there are factors that encourage dynamic capabilities. So if you are working in a growing market, that encourages dynamic capability. Or if in our competition, the amount of our operational capability does not determine our market share, but something else does. For example, our quality is determining our market share, not our potential output. This is not a commodity that we are competing on price, it is more about quality of work. Then you can get a different result, because then in competition, you actually can benefit from not investing in operational capabilities, but focusing on something else like quality. So those are some of the other factors that influence and can encourage investments in dynamic capabilities. If you can decouple resources from prior performance, you can get better investments in dynamic capabilities. And that's one of the reasons, for example, in markets with good financial markets, and you have the option of getting financing based on your expected future performance. So your expected performance becomes more important than just your past performance, and that will allow you to benefit from dynamic capabilities a little bit more. So you can expect in markets with more mature financial markets and lending options, you will get more dynamic capabilities. If the markets have decreasing returns or time compression diseconomies, again, you can see a little bit more investment in dynamic capabilities to be more efficient. So let me kind of stop at this point on the basics of the model and findings of the paper and go to the process, because I think that was there, it had a lot of learning for me. So I learned quite a bit about building models that are not based on a case. Even though I had this motivating case and I tried to tell the story somewhat based on that motivating case, it was a largely a theory-driven project. And it is hard to do theory-driven project because cases really help us have a tangible source of information to make a lot of decisions in our modeling, what we want to include, what we want to exclude, what is the actual problem we want to solve. Whereas when you're doing theoretical modeling, you really need to figure out an alternative way of doing models. So one key insight for me has been to focus on modeling a set of mechanisms. So what is the core mechanism, usually a feedback mechanism, some accumulations, that has not been discussed in the literature that you think is important and has important ramifications, and really, really focus sharply on that mechanism and do not include any other factors in your model, or the model will blow off and become too hard to do analysis. And it's very important to keep the models simple in these settings so that we can communicate with people who are outside of the modeling community. So another important issue for me has been to use the existing theory to drive the building of the model and the concepts that I use. So in this case, the work is firmly grounded in the resource-based view, so people from that literature who read the work and have no system dynamics background, they can still connect with all of the concepts I use. I use exactly those concepts how they use it in the literature, so it's much easier to have the audience buying when you get the paper reviewed by people, experts in outside of system dynamics. They don't feel they are seeing something that is foreign to them. And also it gives us an opportunity to refine their existing theories by figuring out internal inconsistencies in those theories. So Angeli Sastry's 1997 paper is a great example of doing that. It's just finding, using models to find internal inconsistencies and refine an existing theory. And the other important lesson for me has been to use really extensive sensitivity analysis, both on the parameters of the model, but also on the boundary conditions, the formulations, to help build confidence in the generalizability of the results. Now, economists usually try to do that using analytical models that are very simple, and therefore, using analytical solutions, you are essentially embedding your sensitivity analysis in your analytical solutions, because it says, if you change each parameter, what happens to the outcome of the model? Now, we contend that their resulting models are usually too simplistic, but if you want to expand the model's boundary and make our model a little bit more complex, that doesn't relieve us from doing this serious sensitivity analysis that is required for others to trust our work. So I think that's critical to do. Another set of learnings for me is to essentially sidestep this issue of rationality. So there is good evidence that people are not rational in many decision settings, in most decision settings. But that's an assumption that if you start to debate about, you lose some audiences, you end up in fights about assumptions that are not necessarily very efficient for getting the work seen by those who can benefit from it. So what I tried to do in this research and I found useful was to include rationale decision-making as part of a continuum of decision heuristics. And as part of that continuum, decision, optimum allocation policies are mapped. I use them as a benchmark throughout the research. It helps me see policy sensitivity, because what we mean by policy sensitivity is what is the efficient way of doing things, that's the policy that we are recommending. And sensitivity of policy is how that efficient allocation or efficient decision rule changes depending on the assumptions of the model. So we are actually doing the policy sensitivity by thinking about a rational decision making in some way, but we don't use that same term. It also allows us to explore a large range of decision rules, including the rational one, and in my experience have been helpful not to get into fights with reviewers why you are making an assumption about rationality that I don't agree with. And usually you get the reviewer who wants rationality and another one who doesn't want, and then you don't know what to do with it. But you can essentially sidestep that problem using this. And I think also methodologically, we have the room for using game theory concepts in our models. We don't need to ignore them or shy away from them, because they inform something about one point in that range. That is, if you make the rationality assumption, what outcome do you get? And if you don't make the rationality assumption, what result do you get? And is the model result sensitive to that assumption? If you want to know that your results are or are not sensitive to that assumption, so you want to be able to go ahead and do the analysis that is required for doing game theoretic work. So here, I solved the games numerically, and the appendix to the paper includes detailed description of how to do that. But it's essentially an iterative method of optimization. So you optimize for one firm's performance, find them their best allocation policy, and then give every other firm that best allocation policy, and then again ask this firm to come up with the next round of optimization, and you iterate until you converge to what seems to be the optimal. And just a few points, last points on writing for a different audience. I start with Nelson Repenning's 2003 recommendations that you should target communities that are interested in your phenomenon, not just modelers. Ground your work in their literature, develop simple models, and build intuition about the structure behavior links. That's kind of has been extremely helpful for me, and I have been trying to kind of fine-tune and operationalize that advice. So this is how I am, some of the kind of guidelines for me coming from that operationalization. So find, you should be able to name the top 10 researchers in your target field if you are trying to write for an academic audience outside of the community. Because that shows you know that community, you have read their work. And corollary to that, when you're reading the papers in that community, you should be able to essentially identify about 50% of citations that you're reading. That say, okay, I've seen this citation, I know it. That's when you know I can stop reading the literature and doing and trying to write for that community. You will then be able to identify their motivation for reading your work. You should be able to frame your work either as a policy question, or filling a theoretical gap, or solving an empirical puzzle, or testing an existing theory. Those are common ways of framing academic research, and you need to pick one of those. And you can't do multiple of these at the same time. And you need to be very clear from the beginning of your paper that is how I'm trying to contribute to your literature. In my experience, there are different communities with very different levels of sophistication in building models. So some have models that are essentially just verbal. Some have models with a couple of moving parts. You can think of them as stock variables. And you go to mathematical epidemiology, and people have models with billions of variables. So depending on your audience, you need to have a model that does not exceed their level of complexity, or you are going to get into a lot of trouble trying to convince them that this is a useful. Emphasize what is common in their prior modeling work. Do not add a lot of new innovations, only add one piece that is your contribution. Conduct a lot of counterfactuals before deciding that you know what is happening. It's essentially the idea of Luke Makat as one example of counterfactuals. You say, I think this is happening because X is happening because of Y. Well, you have to remove Y and remove nothing else and show that X disappears. If you can't do that, you haven't understood your model. And I see that very often in the modeling communities in general. So that's critical. We have the, this is essentially a scientific method, and we want to use the scientific method in our work. It is very simple for us because we can conduct it through simulation rather than collecting the empirical data. So we shouldn't cut short on that part. And finally, test your understanding of the mechanisms before starting writing. Just predict what will happen if you change all of the model parameters, 10% up or down, to your variables of interest and see whether your predictions are right. That's once your predictions are pretty much all right, that's only when you know enough about your model to be able to write about it. And finally, I address this question of why do we even bother to write for other academic audiences? Because sometimes I hear this tone in our community that, well, we do not need to write for other academic communities. And I have a few arguments that I think many of us do. Maybe not everybody, but a lot of us should do that. One thing is that the solutions are not just technical to complex social problems. A lot of them require changes in mental model. And that's actually a tenet of system dynamics. This is what everybody here agrees with. But the ramifications of that tenet of system dynamics is that if there are concepts that are commonly used in the community of interest in that topic, who are coming from academics, and the academics are influencing that discourse, and your people trust the concepts they have laid out, you need to be able to communicate using those concepts. You can't just ignore them, because otherwise they can't trust you. Some academics are gatekeepers to debates that we want to influence. We can't just completely ignore them. They give us the legitimacy to be part of that debate. And over the longer term, we can influence the discourse as well. The concepts of feedback loops, stocks and flows are now pretty much common. I don't really end up explaining feedback or stocks and flows in most of my papers. I don't really need that anymore. Most reviewers know that. So we have been influencing that, but I think we can do a much better job in the future. And I think without learning from these other communities, we can't even do a better technical solution. That is, not only technical solution is not enough, but we can't do the technical solution that is better than what others have been doing, because pretty much in every field, there are people who have spent a lifetime and who are as smart as we are or better than us to understand the topic. They are analytically as sophisticated as we are, if not more, and we need to learn the language that they use. Sorry, I'm done. So that they can appreciate our work and we can appreciate theirs. And then we can influence them. So I'll stop by saying what John said, and that only Jay can be Jay. So let's try to work with other communities as well as we can. Thanks.